Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for our concert. Delighted to share today's program with you, which you know, I think you're really going to enjoy the variety of works on display, starting with Beethoven's wonderful trio, Opus 70, number 1, more famously known as the Ghost Trio. And it probably alludes to it in your program notes, but the title most likely stemmed from Beethoven's most famous student, Carl Czerny, who described the eerie second movement with its three-note sparse motif as being very ghostly. And he sort of likened it, Czerny, to the ghost of Hamlet. And he was not too far off. Very interestingly, actually, Beethoven's sketches of this trio during the second movement, he had sketched the word Macbeth and death. And it's quite interesting. It's a sort of little known musical historical fact that Beethoven was seriously contemplating writing an opera based on Shakespeare's Macbeth. Could you only imagine what that would have been like? So that kind of sets the stage for the work. It's an interesting piece. It's from Beethoven's middle period. So of course, by this time, he was very much aware of his deafness with his Heiligenstadt testimony. And basically, you start to see Beethoven in his middle period experimenting more and more. In particular, you'll hear in this work, which is three movements, which is a little bit, again, slightly outside of the norm of a four-movement standard work. He's experimenting with form and shape a lot more freely. And you sense, in particular, in the second movement, that the kind of symphonic scope that you'll hear in his chamber works in his later years is just sort of on the cusp. This is Opus 70, composed right in between his fifth and sixth symphonies. So, I mean, he was in full voice in this wonderful work, which we're delighted to share with you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. piece we're going to play is by the Czech composer Josef Suk. He was born and lived around the late 1800s and into the turn of the century. He was a very talented musician. He played piano, violin, and organ, all taught by his father. At the age of 11, he entered the Prague Conservatory, studying violin. When he started to dabble in composition, he was very inspired by his pleasant evenings spent playing trios with his friends. And so he wrote this trio at the age of 15. So this trio caught the attention of Dvorak, who invited Suk to study with him. Suk quickly became his favorite student. Actually, Suk also caught the attention of Dvorak's daughter, and they married some years later. So this trio was written during the happiest of days of Suk's life, and the music reflects a fresh youthfulness. Perhaps he was also influenced by another very famous Czech composer, Smetana, and his piano trio, because there are a few references that pay homage to that work. So unfortunately, as life would have it, Suk suffered two tragic blows. His close mentor and father-in-law, Dvorak, suddenly passed away, and a year later, his wife also passed. Suk was changed forever, and his musical writing style became completely atonal. But for the while, we have this delightful trio to enjoy with its youthful naivete and charming romance. Thank you.
Thank you. So in the second half, we're going to play the Ravel Piano Trio in A minor. And it goes without saying, it's one of the greatest, I think one of the greatest compositions of the century. And for the piano trio, it's always a little challenging to balance a large piano with all of its capabilities against too little, or not so little. Many composers struggled with this, what you'll hear from Ravel is his complete mastery of orchestration. The trio really encapsulates practically every single possibility from every instrument. The limitations are pushed for every single instrument. The techniques used, and the way he balances things, the ranges that he puts our instruments in to make everything audible is truly incredible. So he wrote this piece shortly before the outbreak of the First World War, and he mentioned to a friend of his, so he'd been thinking about writing a piano trio for a long time, and he said to his friend that his piano trio is finished. He just needs to know the themes now. So he was a composer who was extremely specific, not particularly prolific, not fast, not one of these like Mozart that just sort of wrote a piece and you know just before dinner and whatever. He really took his time. He struggled, and he did also with this piece. And even after his pieces were published and released, he kept on changing them. And then anyway. So he was staying in Spain at the time. A lot of influence comes into this piece. It's in four movements. The first movement is based on this Basque rhythm that you'll hear all the way throughout the movement. The second movement is this sort of amazing, colorful affair. Leaping around on the piano, it's quite amazing. The third movement is a passacaglia, so a bass, ground bass with variations that go on top of it, and it's in this sort of amazing sort of arch shape, like the climax, and then comes back down. And that leads us into the last movement, which again is a festival, and finishing in A major. It's not really, you know, given the time that it was written, he started it and then he completed it actually after France joined the war, and he was terribly conflicted because he really wanted to finish this piece, but at the same time he also wanted to enroll and enlist into the army. So he also wrote letters to his friends saying about how conflicted he was at the time, but it doesn't seem to be in the piece, this any sort of sense of war. And shortly after he finished, he immediately went and was turned down for service, actually, because he was a little underweight. But he helped out in looking after soldiers and I think a short period of ambulance driving, etc. Anyway, that's a little bit off the... Yeah, I'm just going to stop now. please enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.